And this week, President Trump said he would accept information about a political rival, even if it was from a foreign source. He later added that he would also notify federal authorities like the FBI about the communication. Phil Matier and I asked former San Francisco Mayor Willie Brown, how do candidates usually get information about their opponents?
Mayor Brown, what is the proper way to get information that can hurt your rival candidate?
Well, you normally will hire somebody to do opposition research. You look at their tax returns, their tax payments, all the kinds of things that might cause voters to think revolting thoughts about your opponent. That's what you propose to do.
So you hire someone to go and get the foreign powers information.
Or you send your son to Trump Tower to have a meeting to try and get the information on your behalf. You certainly don't take the phone call.
But that's only if your son can handle that piece for you so that you'll have an opportunity to explain your son's conduct.
But Mayor
Later.
Brown, yes.
Yes.
What do you think that the president, was he being honest in your opinion, your years in politics, or is he just doing another Donald Trump foot and mouth?
No, it was foot and mouth, pure and simple. He clearly didn't listen to the question, because the content of the question, if somebody said, if some foreign power wanted to offer you dirt on your opponent, what would you do? Clearly, if you heard all those words, you'd be far sharper at responding than he was. All he heard was dirt on opponent. That's all he heard.
Anyway, there's really not necessarily a clear way to even get to the president. It's not like he's got a phone number. You can just call him up and get right to him.
He was a candidate.
You got people around him. You know, ideally, that would not happen.
No, but the reason I say this is because we sit there and go, as a president or as a mayor or as a governor, you're not supposed to do this. But we know it goes on, and usually it's done by somebody who has complete deniability of it happening.
Phil, I hired a person to run the opposition research on behalf of all the candidates that I was supporting. And I even did opposition research on the candidates that I supported, because I didn't want to be surprised about some liability they had that I didn't know about. That happened to me, actually, in Sacramento. I did not know this guy hadn't voted in his life, literally. And I could have said, hey, you know, he was busy in a foxhole or something, if I had had any clue. And I got nailed at the 11th hour after spending $1 million on him.
And so the lesson from that is?
Do the opposition research. Hire some professional, see that it's done, and be authentic, and make sure it's not foreign.
But is the real question about opposition research, because that is commonplace in politics, isn't the real question the willingness to accept that from a foreign power that may later want something in exchange for that information?
Right, and that's why it would be unlawful. And that's why I think there's been such an uproar over the notion that the president may or may not have learned the lesson from this entire, quagmire he's still in over Russians trying to give his campaign opposition research. It's just not clear that he's learned, to say no. Just say no.
Yeah, legally or ethically.
President Trump was advised to fire White House advisor Kellyanne Conway for, quote, persistent, notorious, and deliberate Hatch Act violations. Now, that act prohibits federal employees from engaging in political activities while on the job. And the president has refused to fire Conway. So Phil Matier and I asked former San Francisco mayor, what are the rules for TV appearances?
Where is the line between, if you're working for the government, to going on television and stuff like that, spouting off about politics?
It's virtually impossible to draw that line, Phil. Obviously, there are rules and regulations about the Hatch Act, but whenever you respond and you're already in government, it is almost impossible not to have whatever you say utilizable in the political delivery system, especially if you're me.
But having said that, I mean, the things that Kellyanne Conway is accused of doing that violate the Hatch Act are pretty clear, going after certain candidates for president. I mean, they're not necessarily, on the borderline of things. She's pretty blatantly going out and sort of attacking other folks. But there's some questions. Whether or not she's an employee is a big question. And the bigger issue, I think, with the Hatch Act is that there's really no enforcement to it. Julian Castro got hit with a Hatch Act violation. Nothing happened to him. He didn't get removed from office. There's really no penalty if the president doesn't want to move.
In reality, because of all of the questions surrounding the application of the Hatch Act, Get rid of it. Get it out of the way.
Really?
Yes.
Why? Why should I have government officials campaigning?
No. You don't understand. They are entitled as citizens to participate in the political process and the business of trying to define when that's appropriate and when it isn't appropriate. You either got to say, once you're elected, you can no longer do politics. Well, that's unrealistic.
Yeah, but won't that give an unfair advantage to an incumbent, for example, who every time you want to talk about the environment with the head of the EPA, they get on TV and they start saying things about your opponent. Now you have just a broad-based army of proxies on TV, necessarily, in the news, necessarily.
As a practical matter, you've got to deliver the information for the public to make an intelligent decision. Mm-hmm. And if somebody like your opponent is misrepresenting the facts, you've got to say, this guy is my opponent, but and he's or she is totally unaware of what the true facts are. How do you not do that without somebody saying, hatch act?
I think now that the president is kicking off his campaign in earnest, maybe he might move her over to be a campaign employee, and that way there would be no issue about what her role is to make sure he gets reelected.
But she is one of the most long-serving and loyal of his supporters, so it doesn't surprise me that he's kind of snubbed his nose at this recommendation that she be removed.
Well, you know, again, President Obama did not remove Julian Castro from the Housing and Urban Development position when he was cited for a Hatch Act violation. So I think it's not uncommon for a president to ignore these sorts of things.